For the past 40 years, Carroll Shelby's cars have been burning up the asphalt on racetracks around the world. Whether he was behind the wheel or in the pits, Shelby knew how to win races. These cars had attitude to spare and the horsepower to back it up. But no matter how fast the cars went, it was never fast enough for this Texan with the need for speed.
The formula was simple. Small car, big engine. Hello, I'm Edward Herman. Welcome to the History Channel. From the moment Carroll Shelby's Cobra was introduced, it was a legend. Every car magazine wanted a Cobra on its cover, but they each wanted a different one. Shelby had only one car. He ended up painting it a different color for each magazine. Shelby would constantly show that there was no problem too large that a little creative thinking couldn't overcome. Please join us for the History Channel's presentation of Ultimate Autos, Cobra.
From his Cobra-inspired Mustang GT350s and GT500s to his groundbreaking Cobra Roadsters and Coupes, Carroll Shelby has designed some of the most influential cars of the 20th century. And for those lucky enough to own one of these racing machines, the chance to get out on the track at this annual Shelby American Convention is a dream come true.
We have all different groups, or anything from bona fide race cars to your regular Mustang. And this is one of the few car shows you can take your car out in almost competitive levels and see what you'll do.
Much of the appeal of these cars comes from the man who dreamed up the Cobra and its offspring, Carroll Shelby.
Carroll Shelby is an icon. He's a living legend, and he is one of these people that you meet so infrequently in life who is larger than life. He has the ability, like an alchemist, to put parts together where the sum of the parts is greater than the total.
All of his cars showed his knack for assembling the right team and the right technology. And he showed that American cars could compete with the best from around the world.
You know, Ferraris are beautiful and Porsches are fantastic and Alfa Romeos are wonderful and they're all neat, but it's just fun to be out there in an American car racing with those cars and going fender to fender and being able to beat them.
Creator of these cars, Carroll Shelby, has had a fascination with automobiles since his childhood in Leesburg, Texas.
You know, I became interested in cars before I can even remember nearly. My father was a rural mail carrier in East Texas. And my first memories are that I like to ride around with him.
His father encouraged his interest and would take Shelby to the local bull rings, small oval dirt tracks where stock car racing began. The sights and sounds of the speedway intoxicated young Carroll, and soon he was attending races by himself.
I love racing from very early, you know, my earliest childhood.
Shelby enjoyed studying history and geography in high school, but his consuming passion was fast cars.
The day after I got my driver's license, I asked Dad, I said, could I drive the car around the block? And I took it out on a street. The best street around there was a street called East Pike, which was a four-lane road then. And I got stopped for doing 80 miles an hour in a 34 Dodge, and it was a little while before I got to drive again.
After graduating from high school, Shelby enlisted in the Army Air Corps in 1941. Throughout the Second World War, he trained pilots, tested planes, and delivered parts and supplies around the country. When the war ended in 1945, Shelby returned to Dallas, where his passion for cars was reignited.
I decided, well, I've always wanted to drive race cars. I think I'll just try it. So I started building a car in my garage in Dallas.
By the 1950s, Shelby was burning up the local tracks in East Texas and gaining a reputation as a fierce competitor behind the wheel. While he was paid little money, racing was in the young Texan's blood, and all he cared about was taking the checkered flag at event after event. Shelby continued to rack up wins across the United States, driving a variety of cars. In 1954, his notoriety on the track earned him a spot on a factory team and the chance to race in Europe.
I drove for a team that was not very well known then, but it's very well known now, Aston Martin. And a fellow named John Wire was the team manager. And I used to hang around the factory where they were building the cars, as well as driving, going out and testing.
Shelby learned fast. Of the 111 sports car races he completed, he finished in the top four places 81 times. He won 50 of those races and was named Driver of the Year by numerous publications. Yet driving wasn't the only thing on Shelby's mind. He was slowly hatching a plan to build the ultimate racing machine.
I wanted to drive race cars. I enjoyed driving race cars, but I also knew that I'd started late in life. I started when I was 28, so I better get on with it and decide what I was going to do when that was over, because if you look back over the life of a lot of race drivers, when their days are over, a lot of them are looking for something to do, and I didn't want to wind up in that category.
In 1959, Carroll crowned his driving career with a win at Le Mans for Aston Martin. But poor health threatened to sideline him forever.
I already had heart problems then, and I was having to drive with nitroglycerin pill. The next year, 1960, when I won the national championship, I had to take four or five nitroglycerin pills every race, so I decided that at the end of 1960, I think I'll quit.
After less than 10 years behind the wheel, Carroll Shelby was one of the most celebrated racers of all time. But at the age of 31, Shelby's career seemed to be over. Yet he wasn't ready to give up on racing. He was about to unleash a snake on the tracks of Europe and America. Ultimate Autos will return in a moment here on the History Channel.
Buy an Olympus D510 or C700 and you get the most realistic digital images yet. And now you can store up to 600 of them free. Get an Olympus Smart Media Card free when you buy either camera. Go to freecard.olympus.com for details. Nothing's impossible. Olympus.
Japanese are expecting a war.
Now on DVD and video, history comes alive.
We have to strike the heart of Japan the way they have hit us.
Pearl Harbor. Own it now on DVD and video.
I like to look at things of beauty. They make me dream. They make me wish. They make me smile.
The all-new Lexus ES300, a new world of luxury.
Handle more. Carry less. The Samsung i300 palm-powered phone. Don't be weighed down. Speak up.
Hello.
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 This is the mobile world of Samsung, and everyone's invited.
Last year I was on a cell phone. I said, make sure we have a backup for O'Neill.
he heard Captain Antonio. So that's when we got free and clear with Sprint PCS. Real clear calls and nationwide long distance included. So now, wherever we go, what do we have?
A backup for O'Neill.
The Sprint PCS free and clear plan with nationwide long distance included. Every minute, every day.
Oh, 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 and what would you like, Timmy?
Okay, due to the length of this line and the unbearable constriction of my tights, I'm gonna make this easy for everyone. I'm guessing young Timmy wants America's favorite PC, Adele. And as luck would have it, you can get Timbo here, a complete Dell system with an Intel Pentium 4 processor for just $8.99. And right now, the shipping is free. Plus, every Dell is backed by award-winning service and support. You don't even have to load up the sleigh. Just call or go online, and Dell will help you build the PC that's right for you.
At $8.99, a Dimension desktop with an Intel Pentium 4 processor is the perfect gift for anyone. Call or go online today, and the shipping is free. There's great deals on notebooks, too.
Little dude, you are getting a Dell.
Holiday values made easy. Easy as Dell.
The History Channel now returns to Ultimate Autos, Cobra. Throughout his career as a race car driver, Carroll Shelby had been developing a plan to build the ultimate racing and sports car. In 1962, that opportunity presented itself when AC Motor Cars of England lost their engine supplier. Shelby's idea was to replace the small car's previous four-cylinder engine with a big block American V8.
He called AC and told them that he had a bunch of engines from Ford and he wanted to build a sports car, and I think at the same time he's calling Ford and telling them that he's got a bunch of these sports cars that need an engine.
And I said, if you will furnish me a few engines and give me $25,000, I can build you a sport car that'll blow off the Corvette.
Ford agreed to give him the engines, and AC supplied the bodies. The engines were then shipped to England, and two prototypes were assembled there. The car was ready to be tested. True to Shelby's vision, the powerful V8 Ford engine perfectly complemented the lightweight AC body. On its first run at the Silverstone racetrack in England, the compact roadster was clocking in at 150 miles per hour on the straightaways.
It just goes to show that there's, in a sports car, there's probably no such thing as too much power. And there is almost no sports car that can't be improved by stuffing a larger engine into it.
Carroll shipped the prototypes back to the States and tried to convince Ford to fully back the project. He showed them the car and the Silverstone test footage, and Ford was sold. Carroll signed a letter of agreement with Ford and was sent to the New York Auto Show to unveil the car to the media and the public. But before he could show it, the car needed a name. One night, while dreaming, it came to him. The car would be called the Cobra. Shelby's vision of a powerful sports car had come true, and he used all of his down-home charm to promote the Cobra.
His marketing genius is just phenomenal. He has sold people not only on the Cobra, but the spirit and the fun of driving the Cobra. It's like the surfing spirit in California. It's fun to be associated with the cars and with the people and with the image.
The little roadster even inspired songwriter Carol Connors to pen a Cobra anthem, which put the car at the top of every teenager's wish list.
The youngsters talked about it at home all the time, I think, was the thing that I'm sure a lot of mothers and fathers really got disgusted listening about this, you know, this new sport car at home.
Yet the Cobra really earned its stripes on the track, where it was nearly unbeatable.
That car made no compromises to anything. It was about going fast and winning races and sounding and looking great while doing it.
The Cobra Roadsters dominated racetracks across the country from the moment they were introduced in 1963, transforming the car into an instant American legend.
There's certainly historical significance with the Cobra. It was certainly a high watermark of the 60s muscle car era, if you will, setting numerous records and giving the United States the only World Manufacturers GT Championship.
In 1964, a more powerful Cobra was introduced to help it stay ahead of the competition.
When Corvette went to a big block, Carroll Shelby was there to meet the challenge, and he built a 427 Cobra.
The 427 Cobra has much more torque and horsepower, so you're running a shorter, narrower, less aerodynamic roller skate, if you will, with lots of power.
While his cars dominated the American racing circuits, Shelby had his eye on beating Ferrari and winning a world championship. But the closed coupe Ferrari GTOs proved to be tough competition on Europe's tracks.
The Cobra wasn't very aerodynamic, but most of the tracks we ran on in this country didn't run over 150, 55 miles an hour anyway. So it'd run up to 155 miles an hour and just stop. It was like pushing a brick through the air.
To overcome its limitations, they decided to make the Cobra more aerodynamic by adding a hard top and cutting down on wind resistance. Every Shelby employee was placed on this important project to have it ready in time for Daytona.
Basically, Peter and John Olson and Phil Remington and John Collins and Don Allen and Ken Miles designed this car as it went along.
He had an awful lot of good people. That was one of Shelby's good points, that he knew that he could hire and acquire people to do the job, and then all he'd do is he'd leave you alone. He said, get the job done. Just do it. And we'd do it.
All the hard work paid off when the first Cobra Coupe emerged from the factory in 1964. It had all the power and maneuverability of the Roadster, but its slipstream body let the car cut through the air with ease. All of the pieces were in place for a spectacular racing season. But could the car push past the 160 mile per hour mark? The Cobra was first tested at Riverside by driver Ken Miles, who topped the track record, hitting 183 miles per hour. The Cobra Coupe was ready for its first challenge, Daytona.
When the race started, it was very close between the Ferrari GTO and ourselves. We ran together, but eventually we pulled away.
For 6 hours, the Cobra Coupe led the pack at the Daytona Speedway, but the lead would not last for long. With a few laps to go, the coupe pulled into the pits to refuel.
They started putting gasoline in it, and it hit one of the hot brakes and caught on fire, and one of our boys from New Zealand was absolutely engulfed in flames, but they put the extinguisher on him, and he had just superficial burns.
Scared the hell out of everybody because there were like 55 gallons of gasoline in a drum that we were fueling from, and that was right over the fire. And if that thing would have exploded, we would have had a real mess.
The car was quickly reconditioned for the upcoming 12 hours at Sebring. But this time, fire was the least of Shelby's worries.
It rained so hard that it flooded the pit area, and the tires floated away from the mechanics who were trying to replace them. And it looked more like a boat race than a car race.
Yet the Cobra Coupe sailed to victory. Ford was so impressed, they gave Shelby financial backing for an all-out assault on the European circuit.
It was a sense of nationalism that really took over. A lot of the guys on his crew were Americans. They were hot rodders from California, and they had this underdog spirit that they were not going to let these fancy-talking Europeans with their string-back driving gloves and silk scarves make them look foolish.
Shelby and his team arrived for the 1964 European racing season with high hopes. An earlier win at Spa confirmed the Cobra Coupe's potential. But the race at Monza showed that Enzo Ferrari would be a wily adversary on his home turf.
We had 6 Daytona coupes all cocked and primed, go to Monza, which was our kind of course because it's a very fast course, and When you had long straightaways, we'd just blow the GTO Ferrari off the weeds. It wasn't even close. But Mr. Ferrari was very political, great politician, and he got Monza canceled.
The following year, Ferrari pulled out of GT racing, and the Shelby Coupes won the 1965 World GT Championship hands down.
We were the first American manufacturer to win a world championship, so it was really quite an honor.
Shelby didn't know that his battle with Enzo Ferrari had just begun. The fight would continue in cars that would take racing to the limits. The History Channel's presentation of Ultimate Autos will continue in a moment.
You know what's great about knowing who you are and where you want to go in life? You make getting there an adventure, too. Acura Certified Pre-Owned Vehicles. You know where you're going.
The most unique martial arts performance is captured for the first time. You won't believe the superhuman feats that are performed before your very eyes. The Shaolin monks perform death-defying acts and superhuman feats in an action-packed martial arts spectacular. It's the Shaolin Wheel of Life. They break steel bars over their heads, balance the entire weight of their bodies on nails, and do handstands with just two fingers. And now you can own this unbelievable martial arts show. For the first time, Shaolin Wheel of Life is available on home video. 1,500 years ago, the Shaolin monks of China developed kung fu to protect themselves and their temple from invasion. A cast of 20 Buddhist monks tell this story of the Wheel of Life. It's the legend of how they were almost destroyed by an enraged emperor, and how five young monks were miraculously able to escape and continue the Wheel of Life. Gravity-defying kung fu demonstrations will have you riveted to the screen. These martial arts masters are lifted onto sharp spears and twist their bodies into unthinkable shapes. The Wheel of Life has been called the most spectacular piece of theater ever to hit the stage. Call now so you can experience this astonishing martial arts performance right in your own home. Get ready to witness the most unbelievable, magical, and awe-inspiring moments you've ever seen. Get your credit card ready and call the number you see on your screen. You'll receive the Shaolin Wheel of Life for just $19.98, an amazing price for your front row seat at this extraordinary performance. This is an exclusive television offer that's only available for a limited time. Call for the Wheel of Life and get ready to enjoy the experience time and time again.
You ever wonder where James Bond got his super cool toys? Or what it's like to fly your own private hot rod? They're the ultimate toys for grown-up boys. From private jets and powerboats to million-dollar cars and ultra-hip gadgets. It's the history of the stuff that makes men act like, well, boys. It's a guy thing. A world premiere special event. Modern Marvel's Boys Toys begins January 28th at 9, only on the History Channel.
We now return to Ultimate Autos, Cobra. After his success with the Cobra and the Cobra Coupe, Carroll Shelby took on a mission to build a car that would beat Ferrari at the most prestigious race in the world, Le Mans. He inherited a grudge match started by Henry Ford II, who wanted revenge after his offers to buy Enzo Ferrari's company had been spurned.
Ferrari played games with him. They had accountants there, they had lawyers, and they had a long series of meetings, and finally, when they discussed the actual terms, Ferrari didn't like the terms, and so he just said, I'm not interested. And when the Ford men went back and reported to Henry Ford, he got angry and he said, well, if we can't buy him, we'll beat him.
Ford wanted to beat the Italians at their own game and created Ford Advanced Vehicles in 1963 to come up with a car that would put Enzo Ferrari in his place. The body from Lola, a British racing company, was mated with a Ford V8, capable of producing 350 horsepower. It seemed like an unbeatable combination. But when the new cars, called the GT40s, debuted at Le Mans in 1964, they were plagued by transmission and engine problems. Of the 10 races entered in 1964, the GT40s didn't finish a single event.
The first few cars crashed fairly horribly, and so they started working with aerodynamics and sorting it out, but the car basically was not that successful.
Ford went back to America and brought in Carroll Shelby and his team to take over the project. It was no easy task.
It was a lot of hard work. Everybody thinks that, boy, what a glamorous life. Well, it wasn't really. I mean, it was work, 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 and sometimes you went 72 hours without ever laying your head down to sleep. But everybody was really interested in making a success and being winners. That was the whole name of the game, be a winner.
The GT40s were shipped to Los Angeles, where the Shelby American team began to work on the cars. They had 8 weeks to get the cars race ready in time for Daytona. The cars were cleaned up, repainted, and the engines were replaced. The heavy wire wheels and narrow tires were replaced with Hallebrand magnesium wheels and wide Goodyear tires. Next, the finicky 4.2 liter engine was replaced with the tried and true 289 that was the heart of the Shelby Cobra. Lastly, front and rear spoilers were added, and the car was ready to race at Daytona.
When Ford developed the GT40, it was so full of plumbing and all this stuff, it would hardly get out of its own way. They gave the cars to Carroll, and they just went to work on them and made very competitive race cars out of it. But he had the people to do the job, and he knew how to handle the people, and he treated them right.
With Henry Ford's support, Shelby had created one of the most beautiful and sophisticated racers ever to roll out of his factory.
The GT40 Mark II got the full assault of Ford Motor Company. It was the first car that was engineered. It was the first car that they used computers to design. They put it in the wind tunnel. They put the chassis and the engine on the dynamometers, and they tested it extensively. You know, all of this meant that the GT40 was the first really computer-engineered, high-test race car.
There has never, ever been a program. You can talk about the $300 million Ferrari budget, or the McLaren budgets in Formula One now. We had no restrictions.
In 1965, one of the new Mark II GT40s was entered at Sebring, the race Shelby's Cobra Coupe had won the year before. As the 12-hour race ran into the night, the rain began to fall. As other entries dropped out of the race, the GT40 pulled away from the other cars to victory. The new GT40 had proven itself, but its final test was yet to come.
Well, we did all right the first couple of times out. The field of cars were very impressive at Daytona and Sebring. Now we're getting ready for the big ones overseas, Monza, Targa Florio, and Le Mans.
In total, Ford sponsored 8 GT40s in the 1966 Le Mans, driven by American and British drivers. Over the course of the grueling 24-hour race, all but 3 of the Fords dropped out. But the 3 that remained finished first, second, and third. Ford and Shelby had not only won Le Mans, they had knocked Ferrari off the podium.
Unfortunately, that car was considered by the press a British car. It was still a Ford of England car. And Henry Ford did not like that. He wanted American drivers, American cars. He wanted Americans to beat Ferrari. So the next year, Ford developed at Carcraft with Holman & Moody and Shelby American, the GT40 Mark IV.
With its state-of-the-art design, the Mark IV would be the car to beat.
Mark IV had a very sophisticated aircraft aluminum honeycomb chassis that the suspension joints were epoxied and riveted in place. It was designed out of, at the time, I think it was a Huey helicopter aluminum substructure. And it was the latest, greatest technology. It was state of the art in all the chassis, all the suspension, and the handling and the endurance was just phenomenal.
Among the drivers hired to race the Mark IV at Le Mans were Shelby American regulars Dan Gurney and A.J. Foyt.
The next year, we got Foyt and Gurney, and nobody expected them to finish. And those guys did the most tremendous job. Because you never, at that time, you never drove as fast as you could go at Le Mans. You had to have respect for the gearbox, you had to have respect for the bikes, you had to have respect for the engine.
The battle was on. The number one Mark IV, driven by Gurney and Foyt, took an early lead and just kept making it bigger. Ferrari could not match the speed of the Mark IVs. By the last lap, Ford was first and fourth with two Ferraris between them. Gurney and Foyt had done it. Shelby had given Ford his all-American victory. Everyone associated with the GT40 had reason to celebrate. And for race fans in the United States, the victory cemented Carroll Shelby's place in racing history.
1967, the ultimate American win at Le Mans was made with Dan Gurney, A.J. Foyt, American drivers, and an American Mark IV GT40 with a Ford engine, an American Ford engine. American design beat Ferrari at one Le Mans for the second year in a row. And it was the triumph of Henry Ford over his rival Enzo Ferrari.
Although his cars would continue winning races across Europe, Carroll Shelby was through with international racing. Yet he was about to take on one of his biggest challenges. This would bring his talent and passion for fast cars back to the streets of America. Ultimate Autos will return in a moment here on the History Channel.
Thousands of Americans have made the move to Buick's award-winning ride. Comfort and quality, interest-free. Now, Buick adds $500 bonus cash on every new Century and power-packed Regal. That's 0% APR and $500 cash. And 0% APR continues on Buick's award-winning LeSabre, Park Avenue, even the remarkable all-new Rendezvous. Keep America rolling. See your nearest Buick dealer by January 2nd.
Buy an Olympus D510 or C700 and you get the most realistic digital images yet. And now you can store up to 600 of them free. Get an Olympus Smart Media Card free when you buy either camera. Go to freecard.olympus.com for details. Nothing's impossible. Olympus.
2,000 years, one momentous event.
This story has made its way through history in a way unequaled.
The History Channel sheds new light on an old story. Retrace the journey of a young mother-to-be. When and where was her baby really born? Was Jesus the Son of God or son of a mere mortal?
Could it be the case that Mary was raped by a Roman soldier?
Recent findings bring new perspective to the story of Christ's birth as we go in search of Christmas. A world premiere tonight at 9 on the History Channel. They ruled with force. He would win with faith.
You cannot tell me what to do. Shoot him! He's a priest!
Gregory Peck puts his trust in God and his life on the line. In The Scarlet and the Black on Movies in Time. Saturday at 8, 7 Central on the History Channel. Ultimate Autos Marathon. We'll be right back.
Comes in handy, huh?
It's a lifesaver.
We're looking for a new VP of our Northeast Operations. Stop by my office later.
Hey, Kevin, aren't you the VP of Northeast Operations?
Imagine what the Journal could do for you. Get 8 weeks of the Journal for just 38 cents a day, a 50% savings. Call 800-346-2600. That's 800-346-2600.
What happens when machines fail? What happens when nature rises up? What happens when you have no food, no water, and no way out? Disaster. A worldwide exploration. Wednesday nights at 8 Eastern, 9 Pacific on History International. Call your cable or satellite company to get History International.
The History Channel now returns to Ultimate Autos, Cobra.
Shelby couldn't give the cars away after the Daytona Cobra Coupes were retired. These battle-scarred racers sat in storage for months. Today, the survivors are worth millions.
When reminded, Shelby just laughs.
Even as Carroll Shelby and Ford were battling Ferrari on the international racing circuit, plans were being made to up the ante in the game with the only other sports car in America, the Corvette. Late in 1964, Ford unleashed the Mustang, which was an immediate hit with young buyers. The pony car, however, was underpowered and couldn't compete against the Corvette Stingray.
Lee Iacocca called me one day and he says, Shelby, I want you to come back and talk to me about building a hot Mustang. And I thought, oh, no, this, you know, this is a secretary's car.
Ford told him that they needed more oats for the Mustang. That's the way they used to put it. And they turned to Shelby. He had a good track record. And he put one of his Cobra engines in a Mustang and called it the GT350. And really, that's how the Shelby Mustangs were born.
This GT350 is a racing version of Ford's Mustang 2+2. We set the cars up for racing by installing special components, racing shocks and so on. We're doing a lot of testing as well.
Bringing together elements from his race-winning Cobras, Shelby transformed the Mustang from a pony into a thoroughbred.
Got it done, and took it out and tested it, and sure enough, it'll blow the Corvettes off.
In its first year, 515 GT350s were produced for the street, while 36 were made to compete in Sports Car Club of America events. The cars were ready to race, but first they needed a driver who could handle the GT350. They turned to an unlikely source, Walt Hain.
So they came over to me and they said, Walt, weren't you a Ford test engineer? Yes. Would you test this car for us, please? We'd be happy to. So I took it out and ran a few laps with the car. And they were all had a grin on their face, and they said, oh, by the way, you were 5 seconds a lap faster than the other guy. Would you like to be our driver? I said, well, yes, that'd be all right.
While any GT350 was at home on the track, a special racing model was offered for the more serious enthusiasts.
The R model was even more highly modified than the GT350 then. It was only for racing, and there were 23 of them built for racing, and they would have more highly modified motors and transmissions and suspensions, but they were all built right there in the factory.
In an era when muscle cars were filling the streets, the GT350's racing pedigree appealed to weekend drivers who didn't have the financial backing of Ford to win races.
They sold like hotcakes to these guys that wanted to go race against the Corvettes that couldn't afford the Cobras.
Shelby even made a film to show potential buyers how to drive them on the track.
Most people who enjoy motor racing find the more they learn about it, the more they study good driving techniques, the more interesting the sport is to them.
The Mustang GT350Rs were the envy of hot rodders across the country, and the cars started smoking the competition in small town races from coast to coast. If you couldn't get your hands on your own GT350, Hertz Rent-A-Car had custom black and gold rental cars available for the weekend.
Shelby had a contract with Hertz for 1,000 cars, which he built, and I ran some races at Daytona, the 24 hours, and there was a case where couple of guys had problems with their cars, so they went down to the rental and picked up a Hertz car and drove it through the 24-hour race. They disconnected the speedometer and they took it back, and the fellow said, really, you didn't put many miles on it? Oh, no, we just had it for pleasure at the beach. But I understand that happened more than once.
Oh, they go racing with them, and win a trophy. I mean, you could win your class at any drag strip with them. But then what they started doing, the people with Mustangs would go rent them and take this racing engine out of them and put the little two-barrel carburetor in. Hertz would start calling up, say, we got one of these things that got a different engine in it. What do we do now? It was a fiasco in the end because Hertz just wasn't set up to rent racing cars.
For the 1966 model, Shelby and Ford were determined to increase sales of the GT350 by decreasing the price without sacrificing performance. New colors were added. The interior of the cars were made more comfortable. But underneath this tamer exterior, the GT350s were still pure driving excitement. Even standing still, the cars got attention from everyone who saw them.
They started with the rough and tumble 65 cars, which were hard riding and loud and hard to drive. And each year they modified them and distilled them a little bit so that they became more user friendly.
While the GT350 was enough car for just about anyone, in 1967, Shelby introduced the GT500. At the center of the car was a 427 cubic inch big block engine. Over 2,000 GT500s were built, and with its massive engine and racing extras, it clearly wasn't a car for the timid.
Since this is basically a passenger car that's been converted to, for racing, wasn't designed originally as a race car, so we have to drive it accordingly. When we come out of the corner, then we make slight steering, but only slight, give the gas gently to it, and the back end comes around when it's lined up, take off down this front straight. And it's a technique that you have to drive to match the characteristics of the car.
In 1968, with the Mustang more popular than ever, production of the GTs was moved from Shelby's Venice, California factory closer to Ford headquarters in Michigan. There were few exterior changes in the 1968 models, but the word Mustang was nowhere to be found on the Shelbys. Emblazoned with a coiled snake, the cars were now known simply as Cobras. Inside the new Cobras, a host of new features made the ride more comfortable. Wood grain inserts were on the doors, dash, and custom console. A production convertible was also available with a fatter roll bar with two clips on it, said to be used to tie down a surfboard. In 1969, Ford redesigned their factory Mustangs, employing many of Shelby's options in their Mach 1s, Boss 302s, and 429s. The Shelby Mustangs were discontinued when the new Fords were introduced. The legend of the GT350s and GT500s continues to live on more than 30 years after the cars were originally built. Collectors cherish their Shelby Mustangs and take every opportunity to show them off. For some who were around when the Shelbys were first introduced, the excitement lives on.
I was in college when these cars were first being constructed and built, and I always wanted one back then, but of course, being a student, I could not afford one. So about 3 years ago, I was able to purchase one, and I've always been fascinated with Mr. Shelby and what he did.
Shelby's Mustangs continue to evoke fond memories in the minds of their owners. But for Carroll Shelby, the thrill of creating driving excitement wasn't over yet. The History Channel's presentation of Ultimate Autos will continue in a moment.
This is a Honda certified used car. Even if you take away its 150-point inspection, its comprehensive 12-month, 12,000-mile warranty, and its concurrent 7-year, 100,000-mile powertrain warranty,
you're left with one undeniable, completely comforting fact. It may be used, but it's still a Honda.
Tonight on the History Channel, a gladiator challenges the might of Rome. The army he's forged from slaves triumphs in battle after battle. With freedom and victory his, what made him gamble all for nothing? The real Spartacus. Tonight at 8, only on the History Channel. Thursday on the History Channel, the events that defined the year, the people who shaped its meaning, and the controversies.
This matter will be investigated.
Now is the time to take stock as Mike Wallace presents a sweeping survey of 12 months that changed America.
This is not like any war we had ever had before.
Those who lived it will never forget. 2001, a year for history. Thursday night at 8 on the History Channel, where the past comes alive. Where's the best place to find anything about history?
HistoryChannel.com.
Why go anywhere else? It's the site for information about the Civil War, Egypt, the Industrial Age, any topic, any time.
That's one small step for man.
HistoryChannel.com.
The best search in history. Experience the drama as never seen before.
Our dash towards the unseen shore became a nightmare of sickness, pain, and fear.
Combat cameramen risked their lives to capture these rare images, bringing personal battle experiences to a new powerful level.
There are thousands of things that go through your mind when you believe you are going to die.
The Color of War. Sundays at 8 on the History Channel. Sunday night on the History Channel, they were weapons of mass production.
They were a marvelous piece of engineering.
Brilliant in their design, simple in their operation, devastating in impact. The History Channel celebrates and investigates these wartime workhorses on battle stations. Sunday night at 9 on the History Channel.
We pledge our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
What your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
We shall overcome.
This great nation will endure as it has endured.
We will not tire, we will not falter, and we will not fail.
We now return to Ultimate Autos, Cobra. After 20 years of success on the racetrack, Carroll Shelby was looking for another challenge that would keep his pulse pounding.
He's done so many things, but he's really been able to recreate himself every 10 years. In the 50s, he was a driver. In the 60s, he was a manufacturer and a race car team manager. In the 70s, he basically became a businessman.
In the 80s, when the father of the Mustang, Lee Iacocca, took over Chrysler, he called on Carroll Shelby to bolster the image of the beleaguered car company. His first efforts were limited to adding stripes and decals to the once formidable Dodge Charger. But soon, Shelby opened a skunkworks factory in Whittier, California, where he and his team transformed Dodge Omnis, Chargers, Lancers, Shadows, and Dakota pickups into pavement-pounding hot rods. Carroll, however, wanted to build one more performance car that could match his accomplishments at Ford. Chrysler's vice chairman, Bob Lutz, had the very same idea, and it was one of Shelby's Cobras that offered up the inspiration.
As I drove the Cobra, I thought, we could do this car because we've got this new V10 engine coming for the trucks. We've got a heavy-duty 5-speed transmission coming. We've probably got from the Dakota, we can probably use front-end components and steering gear.
They decided that they'd get the suppliers to pay for it. And, boy, it probably wound up costing $100 million. But it was well worth it. And here it is, the Dodge Viper. This car was conceived and designed and engineered right here in America,
and it will be built right here in America. In fact, what you're looking at even before production starts, I think, is an American classic.
The result was the ultimate production hot rod of the decade. And like every car Carroll Shelby has ever been involved with, the Dodge Viper burned up the track. Shelby drove the Viper as the pace car for the Indianapolis 500, the second time Chrysler had honored him with this prestigious job. Although he hadn't built the Viper himself, Shelby's influence could be felt in every curve of the sleek, modern muscle car.
If you do something that is truly spectacular, that goes beyond people's expectations in styling, performance, horsepower, et cetera, you will touch that nerve that triggers the desire to buy.
A master at promoting himself and his cars, Carroll was on hand to help introduce the Viper, showing it off to the press, as well as Chrysler executives.
I think that that was the main thing that turned Chrysler around.
While the Viper was a giant leap forward for Shelby, his original Cobra was experiencing a comeback thanks to the booming replica market. Not wanting to be outdone, Carroll began offering genuine replicas of his popular roadster.
You could turn back the hands of time 35 years and build the old Cobras and see how that was done, how the craftsmen were welding and building and everything by hand and panel beading and fabricating tin panels and so forth. What we have here today is the same thing. We see guys out in the shop and they're welding and building and creating from scratch, if you will, Cobras all over again.
Some of these replica cars nowadays are stronger, faster, and even better than some of the original cars because of the components that they're able to put into them nowadays. And it makes for an exciting ride.
While the replicas may run better than the first Cobras, for some, there is no substitute for the gritty originals.
Usually the replica is too pretty. It's too nice. It's too shiny. The real race cars don't have the polish. They don't have the paint job that you can see yourself in it from 4 miles away. They were race cars. They were meant to work. And if it's really shiny and really nice, it's probably not the real thing.
The Cobra replicas aren't the only project going on at the Shelby American headquarters. Here in the arid desert of Nevada, Carroll Shelby is at work on his latest creation, a performance car for the 21st century.
I wanted to see if I could build one more car, and Oldsmobile had a good engine. They were running Le Mans. We've had a real struggle. We're only going to build 500 of them.
With such a limited production run, the Shelby Series 1 promises to become as collectible as the other cars in Carroll's stable, and just as fun to drive.
The Series 1 also has some of Carroll's character today, where he appreciates the ability to have a race car type of performance, appreciates today's technology, yet wraps it in a package that's a little bit more user-friendly and has a top and windows and a stereo with a CD if you so desire. Something you could take to the country club.
For 40 years, Carroll Shelby's cars have gained a devoted following, and the racing legend himself frequently attends events sponsored by Shelby owners. Carroll takes delight in the loyalty his cars have inspired.
I'm surprised every day at the number of 50-year-old people now that say, when I was a kid, when I was in school, I wanted a Cobra so bad, and I've got one now. Look there, I had to pay $300,000 for it, but I've got it. And I guess that's what started the whole thing.
One of the reasons that people like these old race cars is you can fix them. You can fiddle with it and see that you've made a change and feel like you've done a day's work because you got the car to go a lap, you know, a second a lap quicker. It's a fun thing to play with.
At events like this one at Lime Rock, Connecticut, Owners of these cherished classics get to experience what owning a Shelby is all about, racing. Whether you're driving a classic Mustang GT350, a Cobra Roadster, or an exotic Ford GT40, every lap is a ticket back in time to when these cars dominated the racing circuits of the world.
They were beautiful cars, as beautiful as anything that ever ran. They made a lasting impression upon all of us.
Shelby will be remembered by me for his marketing excellence. He is a marketing genius. There's none like him. He makes B.T. Barnum look like a joke.
But for Carroll Shelby, it was always about building the ultimate auto.
I like to build cars. That's it. Money, all it means to me is that I'm not starving to death, and it enables me to do what I want to do in life. So you got to have enough of it to do that. The rest of it's wasted because you're not going to take it with you anyway.
From his first Cobra all the way to the Series 1, Carroll Shelby's legacy will continue as long as we have a need for speed.
In 1990, the bad heart that ended Carroll Shelby's driving career finally gave out. He received a life-saving transplant. The experience led him to create the Carroll Shelby Children's Foundation, which helps poor children with heart and kidney problems. It ensures that others will live to see their dreams come true. Shelby hopes to fill a critical need at a critical time. For the History Channel, I'm Edward Herman. Thank you for joining us.
2,000 years, one momentous event.
This story has made its way through history in a way unequaled.
The History Channel sheds new light on an old story. Retrace the journey of a young mother-to-be. When and where was her baby really born? Was Jesus the Son of God or son of a mere mortal?
Could it be the case that Mary was raped by a Roman soldier?
Recent findings bring new perspective to the story of Christ's birth as we go in search of Christmas. A world premiere tomorrow night at 9 on the History Channel.
Now, an exclusive home video offer from the History Channel. You can own the program you've just seen for only $19.95, plus shipping and handling. To order, call 1-800-708-1776 or shop online at historychannel.com.
Buy an Olympus D510 or C700 and you get the